Dear students, today's class is on Biotechnology Application Part 2. Biotechnology, especially recombinant DNA technology or genetic engineering, has got immense potential in various fields, including medicine or healthcare. What is the influence of genetic engineering in medicine? It helped to produce therapeutic drugs at massive scale. So, that is the prime influence of biotechnology in medicine. At present, about 30 recombinant therapeutics have been approved for human use. What about India? In India, it is around 12 in number. So, let us start with the drug insulin. What is the role of insulin? Insulin is actually useful in managing diabetics. So, management of diabetics is possible by taking insulin at regular time intervals. So, what is the role of insulin? Insulin is useful in controlling the blood sugar level. So, what would a diabetic patient do if enough human insulin is not available? That is the diabetic condition. It is just like opening Pandora's box. Several major dreadful diseases are associated with this particular condition. Increase of sugar, blood sugar. Take the example of kidney damage, neurological disorders. These are all side effects coming just because of increase in blood sugar level. So, how to treat diabetic situation? Human insulin was insufficient in a patient. So, we have to administer insulin. So, what is the situation? Now, we have to isolate insulin from other animals. What are the animals? You have to slaughter the animal for that. Slaughter some innocent animal for taking insulin, like in the case of cattle and pig. So, earlier people used to slaughter these animals and get a few quantity of insulin to treat diabetic patients. But the number of diabetic patients are increasing and slaughtering of animals, that is also a major concern, ethical issues are coming. So, what is the situation? Moreover, is it effective? Using insulin from other animals, is it effective? Any chance of eliciting immune response in human body? These are all the questions coming into our mind when you are going to use insulin from other animals. Of course, insulin taken from other animal cause immunological response in some patients. So, in that way it is very difficult. So, we are taking the insulin from slaughtering the animal and that is to having some side effects. So, what is the solution? We have to deal the diabetic patients. So, in this scenario, the only hope is genetically engineered insulin. So, the scientists have learned to produce insulin using the recombinant DNA technology or genetic engineering. So, what about genetically engineered insulin? Think a situation, one bacterium was available that could make insulin, human insulin. The whole process becomes so simple. So, how you are going to make a bacterium to produce human insulin? And before that, you have to understand what is insulin, what is the molecular nature of insulin. Insulin consists of two short polypeptide chains, chain A and chain B. And these two chains are linked together by disulfide bonds between the two chains. Disulfide bond between cysteine amino acid residue present in the two chains. These are all the location the disulfide bonds are made, cysteine to cysteine, cysteine to cysteine. What happens during the synthesis of insulin? In mammals, including human beings, insulin is synthesized as a prohormone which contains an extra stretch of peptide called C peptide. So, insulin normally produced in human beings in the form of prohormone. One additional piece of polypeptide is also attached to the prohormone. So, next step is to get active or mature insulin from the proinsulin. How to arrive that situation? This is the structure of prohormone or proinsulin. Here you can see the C peptide, it is in between the A and B. So, how to remove this C peptide? So, in the case of pancreas, there are several particular group of cells known as beta cells of pancreatic islets of Langerhans, and these beta cells produce certain enzymes called peptidases, especially endopeptidase. These endopeptidases are having a particular property of breaking the polypeptide chain at interior position of the polypeptide. So, that is very it's clever situation. Nature has evolved in a clever manner. Look into the picture, proinsulin, the proinsulin is there. So, the endopeptidase is acting on this point and this point. So, the remainder is there. So, this is the final active form of insulin. Two peptides are there, and these two peptides are joined by cysteine-cysteine disulfide bond. So, the leftover piece is the free C peptide. So, the enzyme involved is endopeptidase from the islets of Langerhans, beta cells of islets of Langerhans of pancreas. So, now let us move on to genetic engineering. The story started in 1983. Eli Lilly, an American company, prepared two DNA sequences corresponding to peptide A and B chains of human insulin. These genes are introduced into plasmids of E. coli. So, what is the situation? These E. coli cells are producing appropriate chains, A chain and B chain. The only thing is you just join peptides A and B. Now, we have the recombinant insulin, the insulin that has been produced by recombinant DNA technology. Okay. E. coli cells are now producing insulin chains A and B in respective experiments. Okay. Chain A and B produced separately were extracted and combined together by the formation of disulfide bonds. Now, we have human insulin. Of course, in industry, there is a term for human insulin, it is humulin. Humulin is actually human insulin. Recombinant DNA technology, athava gene manipulation endannu parishodhikkam. Lalithamayi paranjal, vyathasangalaya jeevukalilulla geneukale athava DNA tanmathrakale thammil yojippikkunna prakriyayanu recombinant DNA technology athava genetic engineering. Athinu aavashyamaya pradhana ghadakangalanu A muthal E vare thannirikkunnathu. A il vruthakrithiyilullathu DNA aanu. Athil pattipidichirikkunna neela nirathilullathu restriction endonuclease aanu. Ithinte vyakthamaya chithram B il kaanam. Restriction endonuclease inte pravarthana phalamayi DNA muriyukayum sticky endukal undaagukayum cheyyunnu. Pacha nirathil kaanunnathu DNA ligase aanu. Hydrogen bond mugayane thammil aduthu vanna DNA sticky endukale thammil yojippikkalaanu DNA ligase inte pradhana dharmam. വൃത്താകൃതിയിലുള്ള ഡി എൻ എ തന്മാത്രയുടെ അരികിലേക്ക് നീല നിറത്തിൽ വന്ന് ഒട്ടിപ്പിടിക്കുന്നതാണ് റെസ്ട്രിക്ഷൻ എൻഡോന്യൂക്ലിയേസ്. ഇത് ഡി എൻ എയിലൂടെ സഞ്ചരിച്ച് സബ്സ്ട്രേറ്റ് സീക്വൻസ് കണ്ടെത്തുന്നതാണ് നാം ഇപ്പോൾ കാണുന്നത്. സബ്സ്ട്രേറ്റ് സീക്വൻസ് കണ്ടെത്തിയിരിക്കുന്നു, അതിനെ മുറിച്ചു കഴിഞ്ഞിരിക്കുന്നു. ഇത്തരം റെസ്ട്രിക്ഷൻ എൻഡോന്യൂക്ലിയസ് കൊണ്ട് മുറിച്ചു മാറ്റിയ ഒരു ഫോറിൻ ഡി എൻ എ തന്മാത്രയുടെ ഒരു തുണ്ട് സമീപത്തുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ അവ തമ്മിൽ കൂടിച്ചേർന്ന് ഹൈഡ്രജൻ ബോണ്ട് ഉണ്ടാകുന്നു. ഇവിടെ പച്ച നിറത്തിൽ അതിവേഗം ഓടി വരുന്നതാണ് ഡി എൻ എ ലൈഗേസ്. ഇത് ഡി എൻ എയിലെ ഫോസ്ഫോ ഡയസ്റ്റർ ബാക്ക് ബോൺ വിടവ് നികത്തി ഡി എൻ എ കണങ്ങളെ തമ്മിൽ യോജിപ്പിക്കുന്നു. ഇത് ഡി എൻ എയുടെ രണ്ട് തന്തുക്കളിലും സംഭവിക്കുന്നു. അങ്ങനെ ഫോറിൻ ഡി എൻ എയുടെ രണ്ടാമത്തെ അറ്റവും കൂടി ചേർന്ന് കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ നമുക്ക് കിട്ടുന്നതാണ് recombinant DNA. ഇപ്രകാരം മനുഷ്യന്റെ ഇൻസുലിൻ ജീൻ ബാക്ടീരിയയിലേക്ക് കടത്തിവിട്ടാൽ ഹ്യൂമൻ ഇൻസുലിൻ വലിയ അളവിൽ ഉൽപ്പാദിക്കാൻ കഴിയും. Now, we will move on to next topic, genetic disorder. There are several genetic disorders. What is the role of biotechnology in dealing with the genetic disorders? So, in that case, we will start with a particular situation. One particular enzyme is there, adenosine deaminase enzyme is there. This is very crucial in immune system to function. That is the role of adenosine deaminase or ADA. So, this ADA is very important to immune system to function. Suppose this particular enzyme is not working or is not there, the gene is malfunctioning, what is the net result? Then of course, it will lead to disorder, a kind of genetic disorder that will trigger several changes in that patient. And altogether, the term is there is a term for that changes due to the absence of adenosine deaminase. The name is severe combined immunodeficiency or SID. This is the disorder arising due to the lack of adenosine deaminase. So, how to treat this particular disease, adenosine deaminase deficiency? Conventionally, there are two methods. The first one is bone marrow transplantation. It is easier to do bone marrow transplantation. It is a conventional method. And the second method is the patients can be treated with the enzyme replacement therapy. So, the patients are continuously given the enzyme adenosine deaminase. So, here functional adenosine deaminase has to be given to the patient at regular intervals. So, these are all the conventional methods. So, what is the problem associated with the conventional method? The problem is they are not completely curative. That is the main problem. You have to go again and again, you have to visit the doctor every time for administration of this particular enzyme. Is there any cure for disease by using the biotechnology? That is the question. How we can apply biotechnology to deal this particular adenosine deaminase deficiency disorder? Of course, there is a new branch in biotechnology known as gene therapy. So, you can use gene therapy to deal several genetic disorders. Here also it is possible. How to deal the disease via gene therapy? Let us see. This situation started in the year 1990, and the first gene therapy patient, the first patient to receive gene therapy was a 4-year-old girl with adenosine deaminase deficiency. And this picture shows the girl, and this is the picture showing the particular girl taking gene therapy medicine. And this is the picture after 9 years, she is at the age of 13, and her name is Ashanti De Silva. She is perfect at that age. Okay. So, this is the success story of gene therapy. Now, we will define what is gene therapy. It is an attempt to correct hereditary disease. Gene therapy is a collection of methods that allow correction of a gene defect that has been diagnosed in a child or embryo. So, a collection of method to correct the deficiency of a gene. So, if the gene is not functioning, you have to provide the gene at you are dealing the disease at the genetic level. That is why it is known as the gene therapy. How to do gene therapy? Take the example. lymphocytes. So, you take lymphocytes from the blood of the patient and grow in a culture medium. Now, you have to introduce functional ADA cDNA into that culture. So, with the help of a retrovirus, which is very useful in delivering gene to animal cells. So, that is why we are using retroviruses. Using the retroviruses that carry adenosine deaminase gene, and if it is introduced into the cells grown in a culture medium, now the lymphocytes are having this particular gene. Next, what is the situation? You just return the cells to the patient, that is happening. But one thing, these cells are not immortal. The patients require, here also, the patient require periodic infusion of such genetically engineered lymphocytes, that is there. But we are now in a safe situation. The cells, lymphocytes that are having the gene, they produce insulin. As and when the lymphocyte with the genetically modified gene decreases, we have to again redo the same. So, the patient requires periodic infusion of such a genetically engineered lymphocytes. The insertion of normal gene into a person's cell and tissues will compensate for the non-functional gene. That is the condition. We have discussed so far addition of gene to the lymphocytes. So, in a nutshell, this sentence states the condition. The insertion of normal genes into a person's cell and tissues will compensate for the non-functional gene. The following animation clearly explains how gene therapy is happening. Gene therapy ude ananda sadhyathakal vivarikkunna oru animation chithramanu nam ippol kaanunnathu. Rakta kuzhalukalude kadathivitta gene vahakaraya virusukalanu manna nirathil kaanunna cheru golangal. ഈ വൈറസുകൾക്ക് ഒരു പ്രത്യേകതയുണ്ട്. ഇവയ്ക്ക് നമ്മുടെ പ്രതിരോധ കോശങ്ങളെ ഒളിച്ചു കടക്കാൻ അനുയോജ്യമായ ഒരു കൃത്രിമ പ്രോട്ടീൻ ആവരണം നൽകിയിരിക്കുന്നു. അങ്ങനെ ഈ ജീൻ വാഹകർ രക്തക്കുഴലിൽ നിന്നും ടാർഗറ്റ് കോശങ്ങളുടെ അടുത്തേക്ക് സുഗമമായി പോകുന്നു. കൃത്രിമ ആവരണം വെടിഞ്ഞ വൈറസുകൾ കോശത്തിനകത്തേക്ക് കടക്കുന്നു. വൈറസിൻ്റെ പ്രോട്ടീൻ ആവരണവും കോശത്തിനുള്ളിൽ വച്ച് ഇല്ലാതാകുന്നു. വൈറസിനുള്ളിൽ ഒളിപ്പിച്ചു വച്ച ഡി എൻ എ ന്യൂക്ലിയസ് അഥവാ കോശമർമ്മത്തിനുള്ളിലേക്ക് കടക്കുന്ന കാഴ്ചയാണ് നാം ഇപ്പോൾ കാണുന്നത്. വളരെ വലിയ ഗോളാകൃതിയിലുള്ള ന്യൂക്ലിയസും വൈറസ് ഡി എൻ എയും തമ്മിലുള്ള വലിപ്പ വ്യത്യാസം വളരെ പ്രകടമാണ്. ന്യൂക്ലിയസിനുള്ളിൽ ക്രോമസോം തന്തുക്കളെയും ഇപ്പോൾ കാണാം. അവയിലൊന്നുമായി വന്നു ചേർന്ന ഡി എൻ എ കണം കൂടിച്ചേരുന്നു. ഇപ്രകാരം വന്നു ചേർന്നത് പൂർണ്ണമായും പ്രവർത്തന സജ്ജമായ ഒരു ജീനാണെങ്കിൽ അത് ഉൾക്കൊണ്ട കോശം പുതിയ സ്വഭാവം കാണിച്ചു തുടങ്ങും. ഇപ്രകാരം പ്രവർത്തനരഹിതമായ ജീനിൻ്റെ കുറവ് ഇല്ലാതാക്കാൻ നമുക്ക് സാധിക്കും. ഇത് തന്നെയാണ് ജീൻ തെറാപ്പിയുടെ മഹത്വവും. ഓക്കെ, we have learned what is happening during the gene therapy procedure. Now, if the gene isolated from bone marrow cells produce ADA is introduced into cells at early embryonic stage, it could be a permanent cure. Okay, that disorder can be cured if the disease is recognized, if the disorder is recognized at the embryonal stage, there is a chance for permanent cure. Only thing is that you have to administer this particular gene into the embryo. What is the situation? The embryo develops into an individual, and that particular individual is now having the adenosine deaminase gene intact. So, we have a permanent cure for ADA disorder. So, now we'll move on to the next topic, molecular diagnosis. The application of biotechnology in molecular diagnosis. What is meant by the term diagnosis? Diagnosis is the art or act of identifying diseases from its signs and symptoms. It is defined in such a manner. Diagnosis is the art or act of identifying a disease from its signs and symptoms. What are the methods for effective treatment of a disease? First one is you identify the disease, you diagnose the disease at an early stage. The second method strategy is understanding its pathophysiology. So, these are all the strategies for the effective treatment. So, effective treatment can be done with the help of early diagnosis and understanding the pathophysiology. Then, how to diagnose, how to identify the pathogen at an earlier stage? It is very difficult. Early detection is not possible with conventional methods of diagnosis. What are the conventional methods? Of course, it is serum and urine analysis, routine checkup in normal hospitals, it is there. So, it is time taking, lot of time is required, and at that time what is happening? The disease is progressing. So, early diagnosis is not possible. Of course, various diseases are there. Take the example of tuberculosis. The pathogen is Mycobacterium tuberculosis. And another example, leprosy. There also the bacterium pathogen involved is Mycobacterium leprae. So, what is the situation? The patient show the symptoms only when disease has been established. So, there are some diseases which show the symptoms of the disease only after establishment of the disease. So, there comes the difficulty, there comes the importance of diagnosis. So, normal conventional method wait for the symptom to arrive. So, what the biotechnology can do in this particular scenario? Is it making the situation more favorable to mankind? Let us see. So, presence of a pathogen like bacteria or viruses is normally suspected only when the pathogen has produced disease symptom. I have mentioned earlier. Okay. By this time, the concentration of the pathogen is already very high in the body. So, one has to remember a disease will start with inoculum. Inoculum is the initial number of cells entering the body, and after a period of incubation, the inoculum increases in number, then it shows the symptoms. So, normal conventional method of diagnosis wait for the incubation time, then only the physician can identify the disease. So, in this scenario, how biotechnology can help the patient? Very low concentration of bacteria or viruses occur when the symptoms of diseases are not visible. Such a low level of pathogen can be detected by amplification of their nucleic acid by PCR. There comes the biotechnology or DNA technology. So, by using the modern technique in biotechnology, that is PCR, you can identify low levels of pathogen, that is at the earlier stages of the disease. It is possible using biotechnology. Now, we will start with the diagnostic method, PCR. What is PCR? PCR is actually polymerase chain reaction. PCR is now routinely used to detect HIV, human immunodeficiency virus, that is leading to the AIDS disease. So, if a patient is reported to have AIDS, so normally people are waiting for the symptom to come, but in the case of molecular diagnosis, you can just take a sample, blood sample from the patient, and you do the PCR analysis, and immediately within no time, within one day, you can identify, we can recognize whether the patient is having AIDS or not. So, that is the power of biotechnology in molecular diagnosis of diseases. Then regarding the polymerase chain reaction, it is carried out using two primers. Unique to the HIV virus genome. Actually, we have learnt about details of PCR in the previous class, that is principles and process of biotechnology. We have to remember the procedure of PCR. You need primers, or forward primer and backward primer. And here what type of primer you are using? You are using the primer unique for the HIV. So, you are using the primer for the AIDS virus, you are taking the blood sample from the patient, you are doing the PCR. Patient is having virus nucleic acid and it is made into single stranded nucleic acid condition, and the single stranded DNA or the nucleic acid is there. Now, the primer can be used to join the virus nucleic acid. Here the PCR starts. Okay. Here comes the PCR. The patient's plasma is treated with the reverse transcriptase. You have to remember the AIDS virus is RNA virus. So, one additional step you have to do. The AIDS virus is RNA virus, its genetic material is RNA. So, the first step is to make the DNA copy. So, that is done with the particular enzyme known as reverse transcriptase or RNA dependent DNA polymerase, which uses RNA as the template and makes a copy, exact copy of the RNA in the DNA form. So, now we are having DNA in a single stranded condition, which is corresponding to the RNA genome. Now, we are having a piece of this particular. Okay. This is taken from the patient's plasma. Now, what about our primer? We have the primer that is specific for the AIDS virus. So, if the patient is having AIDS virus, the complementary DNA is there, then the primer will go and bind to the complementary DNA, and large number of AIDS viral genome has been copied and it is now visible using appropriate biotechnology instruments. So, in that way, within one day you can identify the presence of AIDS disease in a patient. So, it is being used to detect mutations or various other aspects are there. Nowadays, PCR is used to detect several other conditions like mutations. In this case, genes suspected for cancer, that is also possible. If you are having PCR, you can identify genes which are related to cancer, that is also possible. And you can also study what are the mutations occurring in a patient. It is a powerful technique. It can identify many genetic disorders. That is the importance of PCR in molecular diagnosis. Having discussed the molecular diagnosis by PCR, we will move on to next topic, diagnosis by molecular probe. What is a molecular probe? Molecular probe is a small nucleic acid piece in a single stranded condition. A single stranded DNA or RNA that has been tagged with a radioactive molecule. So, what is the situation? You are having some signal in the case, in this case radioactive signal. You are attaching the radioactive signal to one end of the nucleic acid. And now, you are allowing this DNA, single stranded DNA or single stranded nucleic acid to go and bind to other DNA sources. So, you are using one piece of DNA, radio labeled piece of DNA, and you are going to check which are all the DNA pieces combining to this. Is there any binding between the probe or the radio labeled single stranded DNA and the DNA taken from the patient? So, if it is binding, and that process is known as hybridization, if the hybridization is happening, you can identify a particular disease. In that way, this is the use of molecular probe. Molecular probes are small nucleic acid pieces containing label, for example, radio label. There are several aspects are also there. Fluorescent label is there, enzyme labeling is there, several labeling procedures there. Earlier method is radio labeling. So, if a particular or proper label is there, that particular small DNA piece can used to identify a particular gene. So, in that way, you can probe, you can look for, that is the meaning, you can look for your gene of interest using the radio labeled or appropriately labeled small piece of DNA. So, that is the diagnosis by molecular probe. So, you get this picture shows how this is happening. You are having the radio labeled small nucleic acid. It will go and hybridize with the appropriate. You can see several other DNA molecules are there. They are in a single stranded condition, but the probe will go and bind only to the gene or only to the DNA piece. It is having complementarity. You have to remember the term complementarity. So, single stranded DNA, if two single stranded DNA are there, they will bind only when they are of the same nature. That is the meaning of complementarity. So, if the probe is having taken from the gene that is there present in the patient, it will go and bind. And what is the situation? After washing, excess of probes you are washing out, and if that particular situation is showing radio signals, then you can make it sure that this particular gene is there. So, in that way you can identify gene and gene disorders using molecular probes. Several probes are available: radioisotope, normally and conventionally used labeling method. Next is fluorochrome is there, fluorescence using fluorescence, and enzyme or chemiluminescence. These are all available as a label for probe. Okay. Next, what is the influence of this particular molecular probe? This method can used to detect mutated gene by generating probes of normal gene or vice versa. If you suspect a particular person is having a mutation, okay. Now, we can do this molecular diagnosis using a probe. One particular gene is absent, okay. You take the DNA from that patient and you go for the analysis of the gene using the appropriate probe. If the probe is not binding to the patient, of course, the patient is not having the gene. In that way, you can identify mutations that is leading to the absence of some genes. Vice versa, that is also possible. Okay. So, the clone is having, suppose a clone is having a mutated gene, it will not appear on the photographic film. That is the way you are identifying a person with a mutation. Okay. So, the molecular probe is also having immense application in molecular diagnosis. Okay, let us move on to next topic: enzyme linked immunosorbent assay. Enzyme linked immunosorbent assay or ELISA. What is ELISA? ELISA is useful in the early diagnosis of diseases. ELISA is based on the principle of antigen antibody interaction. It is basically ELISA is antigen antibody interaction. This picture clearly shows how ELISA is happening. So, we have the pathogen in the red color. This is the antibody. What is antibody? Antibodies are present in the blood serum of human beings and other animals. Okay. What is the function of antibodies? Antibodies are having the nature to go and bind antigens. Antigens are, of course, several antigens are almost most of the foreign objects entering the blood stream that can be considered antigen. Even bacteria, if one bacteria if it is entering the blood stream, it is also considered as a antigen. So, what is happening now? The blood is having appropriate antibody, and that go and bind to the antigen, and in that way antigen antibody reaction is there. Then how the biotechnology uses this particular antigen antibody interaction? You can see in the biotechnologists cleverly use this particular antigen antibody interaction to recognize the presence of a disease. There are two types of antibodies we need. One is a normal antibody, and another type of antibody is also there. It is having its stem, a particular enzyme linked to the stem. What is the job of the enzyme? This particular enzyme is very interesting. It is leading to a color reaction. When a colorless substance is there in the medium, if the particular antibody with the linked enzyme is there, that enzyme catalyzes a reaction and that leads to color formation. So, that is the second type of antibody linked to enzyme. Okay, now we'll see what is happening during the ELISA. The sample is loaded to the this particular ELISA medium. Then there, what is there? There the antibodies are attached to the solid substratum. So after addition of the sample from the blood, then appropriate pathogen, if it is there, then it will go and bind. Okay, others we are washing out. Okay, now we have the particular antigen attached to the first antibody. Is it recognizable by the biotechnologist by naked eye? No, it is not possible. It is happening at the molecular level. So what is the next step? Next step is the, I have mentioned earlier, second type of antibody with the enzyme linked condition. You add that particular antibody also. Where that enzyme is linked, it is linked to the stem only. So the antigen recognizing part is still free. So okay, what is happening now? Just like a sandwich, below antibody, above antibody, the antigen is present in between. Okay, that is also possible. One antigen can stimulate several antibody. Okay, so first antibody is attached to the substratum and it is having the antigen. The second antibody you are adding, it is linked with one enzyme, it is also coming and binding. Okay, now next step is you simply add the substrate, colorless substrate. What happens now? If the particular pathogen or the antigen is there, this entire sandwich method will be happening and the color is now there. The enzyme starts the reaction, the second antibody if binds, it will start the color reaction. What happens if the pathogen is not there? Of course, the second antibody with the enzyme linked condition will not join, it will also wash out and there is no color reaction. In this way, the disease can be easily identified using this particular ELISA. ELISA is also used to identify diseases like AIDS virus. Okay, some proteins related to AIDS virus that can be treated as the antigen, it is also detected using ELISA. Okay, actually there are several procedures for ELISA. This is the simplest to understand. Okay, now we will move on to the next topic, transgenic animals. What are all the transgenic animals? What is the importance of transgenic animals? What is the meaning of the transgenic? These are all the things we have to learn. Okay, animals that have had their DNA manipulated to possess and express an extra foreign gene are known as transgenic animals. Okay, this is the exact definition. If you ask me in a simple manner, an animal is there, it is having a foreign gene. Okay, it is having a gene from outside. It is having a gene from other source, other animal, any organism, from any organism. If a particular gene is taken and given to the animal, now the animal is transgenic. That is the simple definition. Okay, there are several animals are there which has been experimented for this transgenic animal production. Take the example of rats, rabbits, pigs, sheep, cows, several, even fishes also there. Okay, how can man benefit from production of transgenic animals? What is the fun of making transgenic animals? It is actually fine biochemical study is there for the production of transgenic animals. Several costly chemicals are needed for this particular action. So why people are doing creation of transgenic animals? What is the importance of transgenic animal creation? How can man benefit from production of transgenic animals? There are several reasons, you can name 5 reasons, okay, for the production of transgenic animals. Namely, first one, normal physiology and development of animals can be recognized using the transgenic animals. Secondly, study of a disease, that is also possible. And third, biological products, production of biological products, it is also possible if you are having the transgenic animal. Vaccine safety, in order to understand what is the safety level of a particular vaccine, for that also you can use transgenic animal. Finally, chemical safety testing. Finally, safety of chemicals. These are all the 5 important aspects of transgenic animal creation. Okay, we will start with the first case. One by one, we can deal all the 5 aspects of transgenic animal creation. Why we are doing the transgenic animal experiment? Okay, normal physiology and development. First, you want to study normal physiology and development. Transgenic animals can be designed to study how the genes are regulated, how the genes affect normal functions of the body, how the genes influence the development. So, normally the development of a multicellular organism depends on several genes. Several genes have to be activated at particular point in the development stage, and what makes it possible, how to study the start and off of these genes. For that, you can use transgenic animals. Example, study of complex factors involved in growth, for example, insulin-like growth factor, IGF. IGF is actually associated with the growth. Here you can see the growth in size. The insulin-like growth factor is a typical example. If you want to study the influence of, if you want to study the nature of IGF, you have to use the transgenic animal. So, that is possible. Using the transgenic animal, you can study how the development is happening. Okay, next case, how to study a disease using transgenic animals. Transgenic animals are designed to increase our understanding of how the genes contribute to the development of a disease. Few examples are given. Cancer is there, cystic fibrosis is there, rheumatoid arthritis is there, then Alzheimer's disease is also there. So, these are all the disorders resulting from changes in the genes. So, how to study these diseases? If you have animal model, genetically engineered animal model, or in other words, transgenic animal, you can study. Okay. Transgenic models help the investigation of the new treatment of diseases. Okay. It is the second case of application of transgenic animals. In the third case, biological products. Why we are doing transgenic animals? That is the question we are answering. The third answer is biological products. How it is influencing the production of biological compounds? Okay. Transgenic animals produces useful biological products that can be created by introduction of foreign genes. Here one example is there, human protein, alpha 1 antitrypsin, one particular example, that gene results in human protein. What is the role of this particular protein? It is used to treat emphysema. It is actually a disease related to the lungs, this emphysema. So, this can be treated if the patient is there having deficiency in alpha 1 antitrypsin. Alpha 1 antitrypsin, we can provide the alpha 1 antitrypsin, and you have, if you want to study what is the role of alpha 1 antitrypsin in the disease development, there you can have to use the transgenic animal. In the year 1997, first transgenic cow, Rosie, has been produced. What is the importance of this particular animal? It is producing human protein. Okay. This particular animal is producing human protein in the milk. Okay. The milk contains human alpha lactalbumin. That is the point. Okay. It is nutritionally more balanced product for human babies. Then fourth case for production of transgenic animal is vaccine safety. Transgenic mice are being developed for use in testing the safety of vaccines before they are used on humans. So, that is also possible if you have a transgenic animal. Transgenic mice are being used to test safety of polio vaccine. That is a proven case. Okay. So, what is the last aspect of doing transgenic animal creation? The last point is chemical safety testing. Transgenic animals are used to study the toxicity or safety of some chemicals. So, transgenic animals are made that carry genes which make them more sensitive to toxin. So, normally if you want to study the effect of some chemical on an animal model, the first problem you are facing, the animal itself is having several defense mechanisms. So, the animal is having defense mechanism that will interfere with your study. So, the first thing is that you create a transgenic animal that is having low level of defense. So, if you change the generic makeup of the animal, now the animal is having low defense. Now, you can introduce the particular chemical. What happens to the animal after the introduction of the chemical? That is, it is very easy if you are reducing the defense. So, that is there and that is done with the help of transgenic animal creation. Okay? So, these are all the aspects or these are the points why people are going for creation of transgenic animals. We will start with the first question. Gene therapy is used to treat. The options are genetic disorder, nutritional defects, cataract, acidity, contagious diseases. Of course, we know that gene therapy is an attempt to correct hereditary diseases or disorders like adenosine deaminase. So, the answer is A. Second question. Humulin is, the options are A, antibiotic, B, digestive enzyme, C, human insulin, D, a form of chitin, E, human enzyme. What is humulin? Of course, we know that humulin is human insulin. So, the answer is C. So, genetically engineered humulin was available by the work of Eli Lilly, an American company. So, the answer is C. Third question, which of the following is used as a vector in gene therapy for SID? The options are bacteriophage, retrovirus, TMV, plasmid and NPV. What are these choices? NPV is nuclear polyhedroviruses, plasmids are actually present in bacteria. Tobacco mosaic virus TMV, bacteriophages are some viruses attacking bacteria. Here the answer is retroviruses. Okay? So, retroviruses are used in gene therapy. Take the example of ADA gene deficiency. Okay? Answer is B. Fourth question, endopeptidase from beta cells of islets of Langerhans is used for options gene therapy, molecular diagnosis, C peptide removal, disulfide bond formation, joining the polypeptides A, B with C. What is the answer? We know that endopeptidases are very essential to convert pro-insulin into active insulin by removing the internal C peptide. So, endopeptidases produced from the islets of Langerhans are used to remove the C peptide. So, the answer is C. Fifth question, diagnosis of diseases with a molecular probe involves A, hybridization, B, polymerization, C, Golgi body, D, labeled DNA of host in double stranded condition, ELISA. The answer is binding of two different strands of nucleic acids is known as hybridization. So, the answer is A. Sixth question, low concentrations of RNA viruses in a patient's plasma can be diagnosed by using reverse transcriptase, PCR, DNA helicase, PCR and reverse transcriptase, PCR and DNA helicase. This question you have to remember, it is a tricky question. Before answering, you first analyze the options. Normally, people think that the answer is reverse transcriptase, but you have to remember first thing in identification of RNA virus is to use, of course, reverse transcriptase, then you have to use the PCR, then only you can identify the disease. So, the option D is the answer. Seventh question. ELISA depends on enzyme linked to antigen, enzyme linked to antibody, enzyme linked to solid substrate, antigen linked to solid support, antigen linked to antibody, which is the correct answer for this question. The enzyme linked to antibody, that is helping the That is the crucial aspect in ELISA. Okay? So, the answer is B. 8th question, which among the following is not a strategy for effective treatment of a disease? The statements are early diagnosis, understanding its pathophysiology, symptomatic treatment. Which among the these three are correct? Options are 1 is correct, 2 alone is correct, 3 alone is correct, 1 and 2 correct, and 1 and 3 correct. Answer is 3 alone is correct. That is understanding symptomatic treatment. That is the wrong statement. Okay? Question number 9. The characteristic of molecular probe are 1. They are very long molecule, they are double stranded, DNA or RNA, complementary to a part of desired gene. What is the correct choice? A to E. What is the correct choice? 1 and 2, 2 and 3, 3 and 4, 4 and 1, 4 alone. We know that probe is a small single stranded nucleic acid, RNA or DNA, which may be radio labeled, that will go and bind to the desired gene. So, here we know that the answer is C, that is 3 and 4. What is 3? DNA and RNA. Okay, that the probe can be DNA or RNA. Option 4 means complementarity to the desired gene. Question number 10. Study the following columns and choose the correct answer. First column, there is the transgenic cow. B means emphysema, C PCR, D malfunction of immune system. Then the column number 2, first point is alkaptonuria, second alpha lactalbumin, adenosine deaminase, HIV diagnosis. Okay. So, here this is a very difficult question. In order to answer this, you have to start from one end. Okay. You take what is the influence of transgenic cow. Okay, we know that transgenic cows like Rosie have been used to produce certain proteins called alpha lactalbumin. You can start with that. You know that emphysema can be treated with alpha 1 antitrypsin. Okay, what is alpha 1 antitrypsin? It is used to treat the emphysema. Then this is the condition. What is the disease arising from the lack of this anti? The lungs are having several difficulty. So, normal functioning is not there. So, in a term known as COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. So, normal functioning of the lungs are not happening due to this particular absence, due to this particular protein deficiency. So, in the case of emphysema, you have to provide the alpha 1 antitrypsin. Okay. PCR is used in HIV diagnosis. Then malfunction of immune system is actually resulting from the adenosine deaminase. What about the alkaptonuria? It is having no relation to this first column. So, it is entirely separate. So, you can choose the answer D is the correct one. A D, B to 5, C to 4, D to 3. So, the option D is the correct answer. So, we have completed the application of biotechnology. I hope that you have understood all the aspects of biotechnology application. I will wish you for the coming exam. Thank you.